Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. It's a pleasure to rise in the House today to talk about Bill C-37. Before I do, I hope you'll allow me some latitude to wish my wife, Lisa, a happy Valentine's Day. We're 3,000 kilometres apart, but I'm here doing the nation's business, and she's given me the blessing to be here, even though it's Valentine's Day. So I want to thank her for all of her support in doing this job. Mr. Speaker, but we are here to talk about a very serious piece of legislation, Bill C-37, an act to amend the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act. And I want to talk, first of all, Canadians should be aware that that this debate is now taking place under time allocation, which means the government has decided they don't want to hear from any more members of parliament on this issue. So not only do they not want to hear from affected communities on the issue of safe injection sites or safe consumption sites, as they're now being described, but they don't even want to hear from parliamentarians on this issue. And I think that's a real shame. We're sent here to represent our constituents. We're sent here to speak out on behalf of the people who elected us. And now the government has said, we don't want to hear from you anymore. We only want one more day of debate. They tried, Mr. Speaker, to have no debate whatsoever on this bill. Teaming up with the NDP, they tried to have this bill passed at all stages with no debate from a single member of parliament, Mr. Speaker. It's outrageous that this sort of important issue would be treated in that manner where, again, not only do they not want to hear from affected communities anymore, they don't even want to hear from members of parliament. And I think that's the real issue here. If they wanted to, I've heard today, and we all agree, this is a health crisis. The components of the bill that dealt with the health crisis, the official opposition, the Conservative Party, advocated splitting this bill and passing those sections of the bill immediately. Again, this was rejected by the Liberal government and the third party in the NDP because apparently they want to score political points on this issue, and I think that's a real shame. The points of the bill that all parties agree on include giving the Canadian Border Services Agency more powers to search packages weighing less than 30 grams and ceasing the import of pill presses. We agree, Mr. Speaker. The Conservative Party has agreed. Our health critic has spoken eloquently about that, many on this side. This is a real measure that can be taken immediately to address this issue. But again, the government rejected our attempts to have this dealt with quickly. We agree that we should grant the minister the authority to quickly and temporarily schedule and class new substances. That's a good idea. We could have done that in a single day with a single voice vote had the government agreed to split this bill and move forward on the issues that we can all agree on. So had they really wanted this to move ahead quickly, if they actually cared, and I've heard this again and again today from the government side, that we need to act immediately, we need to act quickly, this is a health crisis, we agree. Why didn't they agree with the Conservative amendment to split this bill and move forward those important measures immediately? It shows that there's politics at work here, Mr. Speaker. What we are concerned about is the community consultation. And quite frankly, I find it shocking that this government that talks about consultation, they consulted on every other measure that they have brought in, whether they have actually listened to that consultation, I think is a matter of debate. But whether it's on new pipelines, whether it's on any number of other pieces of legislation, they've doubled down on, they delayed the pipeline decisions that would have got energy workers in Canada back to work by up to a year. They said the consultations that were done previously were not enough. We need to set up a whole new process and double down on consultation because we need social license to move forward, whatever that means. So they draw out that process on and on and on, ignore the consultation that they actually got, quite frankly, Mr. Speaker. They went with the conservative process entirely when they made those decisions. But here, on something that affects communities, no consultation. I heard it again. The ministers declared it a barrier. The previous Liberal speaker said community consultations are a barrier to safe injection sites, and we need to get rid of them. Well, Mr. Speaker, quite frankly, I think it's reasonable to expect that when a safe injection site is proposed for any community, that the chiefs of police are consulted, that crime statistics are consulted, that the mayor and council are consulted, that the area, the residents in the area where the site might be opened are consulted. Because as the member for Oshawa, the official opposition health critic said, the only way that safe injection sites are successful is when they have community buy-in. And you do not get community buy-in when you refuse to consult with the people that will be directly impacted. We've heard many times about Insight in East Vancouver. Mr. Speaker, that community has said, this is where we want this. This is okay in our community. We have integrated it into our community. Not all communities are East Vancouver, Mr. Speaker. Some are going to take some time to get there, if they ever do. But you don't build consensus by refusing to consult with affected individuals. You don't build consensus by refusing to talk to your community. And Mr. Speaker, that's why I, as a member of Parliament, I'm glad I had the opportunity to speak. I'm sorry for the many, many dozens of MPs that will not be afforded the opportunity because of the heavy-handed tactics of this government. But I took the opportunity, seeing this coming, seeing that the government was abandoning community consultations, I consulted with my community. I sent a brochure to every single household in my riding and asked them two questions. I asked them, do you think communities should be consulted before a safe injection site is proposed in a community? Do you think that's reasonable? That was one question. And secondly, do you think there should be a safe injection site in Chilliwack-Hope? And I had had an extremely robust response. Nearly 1,000 people have taken the time to respond, which is a very high number, more than double the number that I usually get in responses. So the question, do you believe that without consultation, the government should be able to approve these? 76% of respondents said no. They do not believe that that should be able to be done. They don't see that as a barrier. They think it's essential that they be consulted before a safe injection site go through. The second question, do you believe a safe injection site should be located in Chilliwack or Hope? And in that case, 68% said no, 32% said yes, Mr. Speaker. But what I've told, I will be sharing that information, I've shared it with the House here, once the final results are in, I'll share that with the Minister of Health, with the government, because my constituents deserve the right to be consulted and heard. And I think that is the real tragedy here, is that we had an opportunity to act immediately on those measures that we could all agree on, but the government refused to do so. One thing I did want to talk about, Mr. Speaker, the safe injection site model is what the debate is focused on here. But there's another great example that I wanted to highlight from British Columbia as well. And again, BC is on the leading edge of this, and it certainly was troubling to hear member for Vancouver Centre indicate in the media earlier this year that maybe once this issue reaches the Manitoba-Ontario border, then this Liberal government will start to pay attention. Right now, it's just an issue for BC, so we're not too worried about it. This is the most senior member of that caucus, I think, Mr. Speaker. She's been here since 1993. And she indicated that, well, maybe when this becomes an issue in central Canada, then the government will start to pay attention. That's a pretty sad state, Mr. Speaker. But I wanted to talk about the St. Paul's Rapid Access Addiction Clinic. Mr. Speaker, this is something I think that we should be talking about as well, where it's been set up in a hospital setting where people have the opportunity, when they come in and say that they want to kick their addiction, they're immediately walked upstairs and start the process of detox right then and there. And that's what we haven't talked about enough today, is the harm reduction is one of only four pillars in dealing with drug addiction. We have enforcement, we have treatment, and for too long the balance has shifted only to harm reduction. Until we have adequate treatment and detox beds for people to access, I think we're merely treating the symptom and not the underlying problem. But Mr. Speaker, again, This is unfortunate that the government's cutting off debate on this issue. It's unfortunate that they don't want to consult with communities. I think it's a real shame, and it's not the way that they should have moved forward on this important issue. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.